The following is a presentation of ESPN on ABC.
Ah, that sun-kissed embrace of autumn in Texas, shining down on Baylor's glistening football palace. It has been a bounce-back season no one saw coming, except for these Bears. Now they get what is seemingly always their favorite target around here, the Longhorns. Hey, Texas needs a win. It's been an October of what could have been, what should have been. That Baylor line is ready. It is another step on the path to the Big 12 championship game right now. As we welcome you to college football on ABC, presented by Arby's. From McLean Stadium in Waco, Texas, the fifth straight 11 a.m. local kick for the Texas Longhorns as they face this remade 16th ranked Baylor Bears team. And we say good afternoon. So glad you're starting your college football Saturday with us, Joe Tessitore, alongside my partner Greg McElroy. Well, Texas has played really, really well, except for in these fourth quarters recently. And that's the frustrating part, right? Because you got the double-digit leads against Oklahoma State, the strong, fast starts, but not able to close out these games lately.
And it's got to be frustrating, but right now the season's at a crossroads. The level of urgency for this Texas team is at an all-time high because you're looking at a situation losing three in a row is almost impossible to come back from. And you look at it, too. This is a team that 3 weeks ago was in prime position to take down their arch rival. Now, staring down the barrel of a potential 500 season, if not victorious, here today. But the good news is they have one of the best players in college football. It's Bijan Robinson. He's their running back. He is absolutely electric with the ball in his hand. So versatile in the backfield. Also very good at contributing to the pass game for the Texas Longhorns. He's one of the best players in the country at his position. And he's going to be a guy that the Baylor Bears are going to have a very difficult time containing throughout the course of this game.
Goes for 132 rushing yards per game. And here come those Baylor Bears. They're nothing like they were a year ago. From two wins in 2020 to already bowl eligible and hammering home the number one total offense in the Big 12. They can run the ball. They can play power football here in Waco. Very dangerous and hungry Texas team. A push you around Baylor Bear squad. College football presented by Arby's returns after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Beautiful day here in Waco as you're watching the Big 12 on ESPN. Texas won the toss. They elected to defer. 111th all-time meeting. Baylor's second most against any opponent. Let's go to Katie George.
Well, guys, Steve Sarkisian during the bye week spent time talking about his team's psyche, not scheme. Rather than watching game tape of the fourth quarter lulls, he showed his team a variety of documentaries, from Michael Jordan to Alex Hanold, the rock climber in free solo. Execution, preparation, precision were among the talking points from Steve Sarkisian. He said, look, we prepare really well. That's what leads to the first half leads that we get, but the game's not over. We still got 500 feet that we've got to climb to get to the top of the mountain. He wants to see his team finish. He hopes they're able to do so today.
Katie, that was a brilliant report to set the table for the mentality with Sark in Texas, as Kelton and Lane from the crew were greatly distracting in the background on this Halloween. Gary Bohannon, first completion goes to Sneed, and Sneed with yards after the catch. Keys to the game brought to you by Jared.
Well, for Baylor, they need to continue with their identity offensively. They need to be physical. They need to run the ball and impose their will at the line of scrimmage. They also need to stay on schedule, get ahead of the sticks. This Texas defense, very athletic. You don't want to have negative yardage plays. And then for Texas, you got to win one-on-ones, both at the line of scrimmage and on the perimeter. And you got to be really strong at the point of attack, particularly on the edges of the defense against this run game.
22 yards on that reception, 19 after the catch by Sneed. And that ball is intercepted. B.J. Foster with the pickoff and the return. So Gary Bohannon, who has only thrown one interception on the year, picked off on the second play of the game.
And this is a great job by the backside safety. Because of the formation, 3-by-1 to the left, the backside safety, Foster, is able to read the quarterback's eye. So he pushes to the 3-by-1, and he jumps right in front of the middle of the field post. A great interception, just a bad job there by Gary Bohannon, a guy that has made great decisions throughout the course of the first couple months of the season, makes a bad one there, and Texas turns it into an excellent play defensively.
So Texas begins on the Baylor 31, and that is not the norm for Baylor this year. Their opponent drive starts has averaged their own 25. Casey Thompson, he opens up with a completion as spinning down to the 16-yard line is Joshua Moore. 81 of 82 drives have started in opponents' own territory. 99% Baylor opponent drive starts, and now a turnover for Texas to open up this game. Thompson quickly gets it to Cade Brewer, the tight end, and he is met immediately. Only 1 yard there. So Casey Thompson, who replaced Hudson Card, who was the starter to begin the year. And then Thompson went on to lead Texas to 3 wins in his first 3 starts. Leads the Big 12 in passer efficiency.
He's been very steady. I mean, accurate with the football, makes good decisions, and hasn't been rattled. Hudson Card, a little bit rattled in the Arkansas game. They turn to Thompson. He's steadied the ship, even though they've come up a little bit short the last couple weeks.
Of course, he's got number 5 in the backfield, Bijan Robinson. Robinson able to get to the edge and darts near the 10-yard line, run out by Christian Morgan. It's 5 yards there.
Just get the first look there at Bijan Robinson, one of the most electric playmakers in college football. B.J. Foster giving his offense the short field. Big play here for the Baylor defense. Sudden change, you're backed up, difficult starting spot. To get off the field with only a field goal would be enormous for what's been a very good group for Dave Aranda.
3rd down and 4. Thompson with time to the end zone, and that's a touchdown. Joshua Moore, quick strike, Longhorns. Ten-yard touchdown pass, Thompson to Moore.
Well, you can tell that Baylor made it about Bijan Robinson with their defensive prep. Look at the safety here for Baylor. This is Morgan, eyes in the backfield, coming up to stop the run. This is an RPO for Texas. He can hand it off, but if the safety collapses and commits to the run, you can throw the slant in behind it. Just a great read there by Thompson, a very accurate throw to beat what was solid coverage.
That is exactly what Texas has been doing. Starting fast, all about finishing, sustaining, focus. They take a short road trip here to Waco. And Thompson says, that's gonna be the early knife right at you, to Joshua Moore. Well, there is the Longhorn Band, the show band of the Southwest on our AT&T 5G Skycam. They're up there in section 329, Greg. As our producer Scott Matthews notes, the reason they're in section 329 is because there wasn't a 429. That's where the guests are going to put you.
Nothing like good Southern hospitality, right?
Well, Bohannon threw that interception moments ago, Katie.
Yeah, I did. And guys, as I spoke with Baylor players throughout the week, each one referenced Gary Bohannon's confidence. They said his confidence is contagious. He came over to the sideline, had a quick conversation with RJ Snead. He was calm, unfazed, even had a smile on his face. This is a guy who doesn't throw picks often. Let's see how he responds now.
Yeah, Baylor's offense came in ranked 4th nationally in interception percentage.
You can update that 1 on the bottom to 2, doubling up his season total, but he's been so steady and is a young man that has really earned this position and the respect of his teammates.
This is Abram Smith, who was playing defense a year ago on the carry. As he goes for 7 yards. And Gary Bohannon, we had a conversation with the offensive coordinator, Jeff Bryans, Greg, and he said you could see it day 1 of fall camp that this was someone who bet on himself, and he just continued to work and get better, and that confidence started to blossom right away in August.
Very much. They've done a great job of calling the offense Jeff Grimes has to his strengths, being smart, using his athleticism, getting him out of the pocket, and complementing this run game.
Smith on second and three. That's a run game they have leaned on a lot, and that'll be a first down. Jeff Grimes, who was with BYU as the play caller last year, was a finalist for the Broyles Award. He calls this offense not the RPO, but the RVO, reliable, violent offense.
And I love the way he put this thing together. I mean, the different formations, how they mix run pass, how they make it all look very similar. I think it's a very simple offense for the players to learn and understand and execute, but difficult for defenses to be able to read the keys.
Bohannon on first down gets it out quickly. He does so to Drew Estrada, the transfer from Dartmouth. So Drew Estrada goes from Molly's Bar up in Hanover, New Hampshire, to Tony DiMaria's Barbecue here in Waco in the span of a year.
Love that. But back to Jeff Grimes. I think this guy is one of the best coaches in college football. I really believe that. He's done such a great job for so many years. Comes from that offensive line background, and I think he's going to be a head coach probably sooner than later, and probably should have had opportunities in the past and likely will here coming up very soon in the future.
12-yard completion to Estrada. Bohannon had to get it out quickly as there was some pressure coming after him.
And here's Jeff Grimes. As you can see, all the stops. I mean, he's been all over the place. Of course, the offensive line is his background, but he actually throws the ball, which is kind of different for offensive line coaches that are calling plays. He, of course, really cut his teeth at LSU, where they had an excellent run with Leonard Fournette. Taking over at BYU, bringing Zach Wilson to the national spotlight, and then here, the impact he's made already in year number one is profound.
Second down throw by Bohannon as he gets it right to that line to gain to Tyquan Thornton.
You can see him, and I think sometimes when you're looking at future head coaching candidates, the offensive line's a great place to start, because in that room you have so many personalities, and it's a deep room where there's 20 guys in some cases, depending on the school. And being able to bring that group together and to create that camaraderie and that chemistry, you don't mess with the offensive line. And I think when you can find coaches that have had experience coaching that position, they usually lead to great success.
Sam Pittman, Mario Cristobal, some examples as Tristan Ebner takes the carry. Luke Brockermeyer with the tackle of Ebner. You know, Grimes says, listen, we're going to run a few plays a lot of different ways. Going to keep it simple, but just dress it up a little differently.
It's easy on the players and very difficult on the opponents. Commitment to the run game, too, is just outstanding. And that's been such a wonderful statement that they've made here at Baylor with the physical and imposing run game.
Second and five, nothing happening there at all as Overshown charges in for the tackle. He's always around the ball. 35th start of his career today.
And Overshown's going to have to be excellent today, because this Baylor defense, they really want to run it outside the tackles. It's kind of where they live. So it's going to force both Overshown and his partner in crime, Luke Brockermeyer, the linebackers for Texas, they're going to have to do a great job playing sideline to sideline.
Third down and seven. They run option. Here's the pitch to Ebner, and he catches a lane. And with it, the first down. Well-designed play as Ebner takes it ahead to a first down on an 18-yard run.
And a great job running this play away from rotation. You see the safeties rotate. That means your run support's coming to the left. They attack the right, and they jump leverage immediately. There's nobody home as they pitch off the unblocked defender. Just a great play call there, taking advantage of the rotation from Texas and getting an easy first down.
Ninth play of this drive coming. Opening series was an interception thrown on the second play of the game. Here's Sneed, and they are able to corral him as he works his way inside the 15-yard line as he goes for 7 yards on that catch.
The defensive coordinator for Texas, Pete Kwiatkowski, they've done a great job this year at keeping plays in front of them and doing a good job of not giving up the big plays. I think Baylor came into it expecting that. They're doing a good job of attacking the underneath so far, as you see Pete Kwiatkowski in year number one in Austin trying to implement a little different style than what they've run in the past.
14 years, he was the right-hand man for Chris Peterson at Boise State and Washington, and now with Sark at Texas. Second and three inside the 10, and upended that time was Snead, but it'll be first and goal Baylor, a very well-managed second possession by Gary Bohannon.
Very smart, he's taken what the defense has given him, gotten the ball out of his hands quickly. It's also been very well called by Jeff Grimes, the offensive coordinator. This part of the field, this is where they just pound you. They just try to run the ball, and they use that physical presence up front to get it in the end zone with one of their outstanding running backs.
End around trick play, looking to pass, and into the end zone for a touchdown as Thornton goes to Snead. Tyquan Thornton with a touchdown pass to R.J. Snead.
How about the changeup to what's become a very popular play, Philly special? No, Nick Foles isn't in the flat. You're going to throw it back across the middle, which you're told never to do as a quarterback, but I guess if you're a wide receiver, the rules don't apply. What a great read there as they connect for the trick play touchdown.
What did you say? You can lean on that power running game? How about a little trickery for Baylor? And that ties us up 7-7 here in Waco.
College football on ABC is presented by Arby's. We have the meat.
Some of our families getting ready for Halloween. Children of our crew members, great looking bunch. What about your boys? You getting the boys dressed up for home?
Yes, we got in true company fashion, we're going with Buzz Lightyear and Woody.
Well, I like it.
Very excited about it.
I like it.
A little Toy Story tip of the cap. The dogs are going as Mr. Potato Head, by the way. Both of them.
7-7 here after Thornton and Snead hooked up on the trick play for Baylor. Let's check in with Kevin in the studio. Thank you very much. There's Tyquan Thornton, who just threw the touchdown pass. The receiver who did play quarterback his senior year at Booker T. Washington High School in Miami. Tim Ice Harris, the head coach, said, I'm going to put him at quarterback. And he threw three touchdown passes that senior year and just threw one here against Texas.
Delay game. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
That's a head shaker for Coach Sark.
It's 2 weeks in a row now where we've seen offenses come out and there's just really no urgency. Of course, Sark wants a reset. Every time, by the way, there's a delay of game, just do that motion. Maybe the ref will buy it. I used to use it all the time. I don't think I ever got an official to reset the game clock, though.
Casey Thompson, pressure up the middle. He cannot escape it. Siaka Ika rains down on him. All 350 pounds crashing down on Casey Thompson.
And a great job at the second level, too. You're going to see the linebacker hit it. As soon as Bijan Robinson leaves and isn't there to protect, it's almost as if he forgot that he had protection responsibility. The backer's unblocked. And then Ika's there to clean it up, the big body transfer from LSU.
Puts him in a hole of a second and 23. Robinson will get it to the 15-yard line, met by Gabe Hall.
This is just not the spot where Texas can be with their run game and the relative inexperience of Casey Thompson. He's a veteran player, been around for a long time, hasn't started that many football games. You absolutely have to stay on schedule against a defense like this that can get after the quarterback and have very active and instinctive linebackers. You cannot be in third and long throughout the course of the game.
Third and 20, they'll just play it with Robinson, who can't find anything on the left side as Dylan Doyle tracked him down with the pursuit, and Texas will be punting away. So the sack put him in a hole, and they could never dig out on that position.
And a great job there by Baylor's defense. Of course, the sack that you alluded to, just a great trigger at the second level. And Dave Aranda, he's got some excellent, excellent players on the defensive side. Maybe not all NFL All-Pro type of caliber guys, but man, they're instinctive and they make great decisions at all three levels.
Cameron Dicker, to punt away, had a 77-yarder against Oklahoma State, had a 78-yarder against Oklahoma, and he's able to flip the field here with a 58-yarder. So Baylor Bears, this beautiful campus here in Waco, they're back on offense when we return.
Copycat world in football, so you're going to see Philly special, all right? That's basically this. You hand it off, quarterback leaks out in the flat. Well, Texas has seen it too, because look at how they cover it up on the last touchdown for the Baylor Bears. Two Texas defenders, I mean, just beelining right for the quarterback, only to find the wide receiver in the back of the end zone wide open, but the reaction from Texas is classic as you see the safety hand a helmet.
Good lane for Abram Smith on the first down run for Baylor.
Guys, did you know Alabama recruited Gary Bohannon to play linebacker? LSU recruited him as well, but not as a play caller, and there were many others. Bohannon said he was 16 at the time. He smiled, told all those coaches he wanted to play quarterback, and that desire never changed. He said he wanted the ball in his hands every play to dictate outcomes of the games. He says he loves being the person teammates depend on. He wasn't willing to give up on that.
And Katie, that goes to that conversation we had earlier about Jeff Grimes, the offensive coordinator. Second and one to the top of the screen there, and that's incomplete, where Grimes said, listen, you could tell he's the kind of kid who bet on himself, who was determined that this was going to be his role, his team.
Yeah, and that commitment level in fall camp, I mean, Grimes said he'd get there, and I think it was a little bit of a humble brag. He said, I get there at 6:30, leave at 10:30. Gary was there the entire time and beyond, Katie, when Jeff Grimes came and left from the office.
Well, even Greg, when he got the job, he made calls to all the offensive players. He started with the quarterbacks, Gary Bohannon being that first call. And he said he couldn't get Bohannon off the phone. He said that he was asking, Coach, can you send me the playbook like today? And he was like, no, Gary, I can't send it today, but I'll get to you as soon as possible. So he showed an eagerness and a willingness to want to learn this offense and get better. And it's coming to fruition now.
Just hit the freshman Gavin Yates, who then was hit by Josh Thompson, but 3 yards, able to move the chains.
This offense is going to go as the quarterback goes. Last year, the quarterback just happened to go number two overall to the New York Jets. So having a good quarterback that makes great decisions is imperative for this offense to be at its best.
As Ebner gets the carry. Of course, that's BYU's offense from a year ago. Jeff Grimes, the play caller there. It's such success. And then he comes here, and, you know, he had really a play caller's dream game in their last game, Greg. He went for 534 yards of offense, and it was penalty-free. A penalty-free game. That was the win over BYU, their first penalty-free game in program history.
It's amazing. It really is amazing.
Smith, look at this hole, and then lowers the shoulders inside the 40. This is what they do best.
This is a great cut by Smith. This is an offense that really wants to live outside the tackles. However, they can gash you on the inside as well. Just an excellent cut back there from Abe Smith. Running physical, too. That's exactly what Grimes desired. When they moved him from linebacker to running back, they wanted that physical presence. For this offense to really get going, they need a back that's committed to getting north and south. Abe's been that guy throughout the course of the season.
Played 8 games at linebacker last year. Flag is down. So originally a running back, then he moved to linebacker in 2019, then moved back to running back this past spring. They wanted a little more physicality in the backfield during spring practice, and Abram Smith has been something special for him.
Personal foul, hands to the face, defense, 15-yard penalty and automatic, first down.
Saturday Night Football is presented by Capital One, and it's a good one tonight. With the way C.J. Stroud, Trevion Henderson, and the Ohio State offense are playing, it's in Columbus as number 20 Penn State takes on fifth-ranked Ohio State, 7:30 Eastern on ABC.
As you go back to this penalty, you're going to see right here, middle of the screen, hand to the face. The helmet actually comes off of Jacob Gall. It's a good call there by the umpire.
First down at the 24. Bohannon gets it out quickly, and that was well defensed as he was trying to get to Thornton, but Darian Dunn came crashing in.
And that's a play right there. If you're the quarterback, you put that one in your mind. And if you're a play caller, you put that one in your mind, because if you look at the defender right there, Darian Dunn, he crashed on that hitch quickly. So what does that mean? Hitch and go's coming. Stutter go's coming. Double move's coming. They're going to squat on the underneath. Make sure you mark that one in your head and you get another chance. You get him in one-on-one. Double move, hit him over the top.
See if Coach Grimes tucks that one away. Smith, nothing. That ball came out and it went backwards, but Baylor was able to recover it. As jumping on it quickly there was Xavier Newman Johnson, the left guard.
And that ball just came flying backwards. Good job there, too. Looked like Coburn was the one that was able to dislodge the big defensive tackle, number 99. He's a handful in the middle of that defense as he was working against Xavier Newman Johnson there on the left side of the offensive line.
And now an opportunity for the Texas defense. Third and 13. Four-man rush goes underneath, well short of the line to make to Snead, who tries to wiggle his way free and works it back to the 20-yard line where B.J. Foster wraps him up.
Good job there by the Texas defense. They have the hands of the face that gets Baylor on the move. Back is against the wall, and they force a negative play. They, of course, do a good job at the line of scrimmage in that run play, and getting Baylor off schedule is not something that Baylor is going to be very successful at on those third and long. So a great job there by the Texas defense.
So Isaiah Hankins, the freshman, preferred freshman walk-on, who shocked everyone overtaking the starter John Mayers in fall camp, and he's been solid, 7 of 8 on the season. This from 38. The lefty up and through. So Baylor makes the most of it. 10-7 lead. This season, along with their contributions to university's general scholarship funds for every field goal and extra point made, Allstate will also be donating to the American Red Cross to help with disaster relief efforts. Thank you, Allstate. R.J. Snead has the touchdown catch for Baylor today. R.J. Snead, who teammates call Allstate. That's his nickname, because they say they're always in good hands with R.J. Snead. And his nickname around the team is Allstate. And he had the 6-yard touchdown catch on the trick play from Tyquan Thornton.
Got some great costumes. I mean, all over the place, man. I love being on campus this weekend. It's always so much fun.
Start of a busy day in college football. To get us up to speed, here's Kevin. Thank you very much. And we're back to business here with the Texas offense.
Maybe a little payback there from Miami after Pitt upended their season a few years ago.
In stride, Casey Thompson is able to connect with Joshua Moore.
As you see, Texas has been one of the best teams in college football, getting off the bus and being ready to rock. And Steve Sarkisian referenced it in our visit yesterday, saying, man, we have a great plan every week. We put a lot of time and effort into our starters. It's just we haven't finished very well. Well, so far, haven't been quite as efficient offensively as they normally are in the first quarter.
Thompson going to take a shot downfield, wide open, and in stride is Worthy. Three-yard touchdown, Xavier Worthy, the dynamic freshman.
Well, just when you're saying they hadn't been quite as efficient offensively, they take the top off. What a beautiful throw from Thompson as the freshman gets free.
That is his 11th play over 20 yards on the season. His seventh touchdown catch already. Fourteen to 10, Texas.
What a thing of beauty right here. Just a slot fade, and they're in cover three. So you got to think that this corner's going deep. Stay deep as the deepest. You're actually going to see the slot defender. Look at him look out to the flat. Look at his eyes. His eyes are actually out wide thinking, oh, man, oh, well, I better cover it. If you're not going deep, I better go deep. So right there, a little bit of a miscommunication and a great job there of Texas taking advantage of that miscommunication and a perfect throw from Casey Thompson to the excellent freshman Worthy. Talked to Dave Aranda throughout the course of our call yesterday. Said, man, the one guy that we really need to be concerned about for them offensively in the pass game is number 8. We cannot allow him to get one-on-ones. Well, sure enough, here at the end of the first quarter, Worthy gets over the top and catches his 7th touchdown of the season.
He's closing in on a Texas record. Dave Aranda looks on Xavier Worthy, and this is a guy who has the most receiving yards of any freshman in Power 5 football. Ebner on the return. Ebner goes up and over, but there wasn't enough real estate remaining. Good pace early on in this game, huh? Remember, Saturday Night Football on ABC. Take you to see Penn State and Ohio State, number 20 against number 5, critical game in the Big Ten. Monday Night Football, the Giants and Chiefs, and of course, Peyton and Eli will be on ESPN2 for everything related to Monday Night Football, breaking it down, providing a few laughs along the way.
I'm excited for that Penn State-Ohio State game tonight. A lot of people think, well, Penn State, you know, they lost to Illinois. I think they're going to have something up their sleeve.
They're going to be able to match points with that offense?
I don't think so. I think they lose. But
Wait a minute. I thought you were selling the game here, McElroy.
No, they're going to lose the game, but I would be surprised if it got sideways. That's for sure. I would be real surprised. James Franklin will get those guys ready to rock. I think last week, tough spot for Penn State. Kind of a look-ahead scenario. Illinois grabs them. I'd be surprised if they didn't play really good football tonight.
Well, Texas struck first. They had the interception that they turned into quick points when Thompson hit Moore. But then Baylor came roaring back with the trick play. And then fireworks again to close out the first quarter with Xavier Worthy. College football presented by Arby's returns after this message and a word from our ABC station. Start of the second quarter here in Waco, Texas 14-10. Texas with Bijan Robinson and a lead, and they had one rushing yard in the first quarter. It was the passing game and the big strike downfield to Worthy moments ago that gave them the lead. Short pitch to Smith. Good lane by Smith. Good speed by Smith. And a chunk play to open up this second quarter for Baylor. Chris Adamora had to finally run him down, but he went for 32 yards.
And a great job on the end of the line of scrimmage as you see the two tight ends for Baylor on the left-hand side secure that edge, capture that edge. It's called a pin and pull, where you pin the defender down, you pull two offensive linemen out in front, create some additional gaps. That's very difficult to defend. It was perfectly executed by the Bears offense.
Smith already at 69 yards rushing. And checking over Jeff Grimes. Keep it on the ground with Ebner, and he will be tackled just behind the line of scrimmage. Agofu coming in and making a nice play, the transfer from Notre Dame. He has three tackles for loss coming into this game.
And this Texas defense, of course, it's going to be a challenge. You're playing against one of the best, most efficient offenses in the Big 12. The tough thing about this offense is they can run it and throw it, and they can beat you multiple ways. So their balance is what makes it very challenging. So really an awful lot on these linebackers for Texas.
Second and 10. Smith, not much there.
Right here, if I'm Jeff Grimes, I like the idea of getting Gary Bohannon out to the field here. I'd roll him to the right. He's a very good athlete. So in this third down medium type situation, I like to give him the option to potentially run it if he likes it. So I would move the pocket. I'd roll him to the right, give him plenty of field, and if nothing's there in the passing game, maybe he can create with his legs.
Seven balance of time of possession. Third down and 6. That ball is incomplete as R.J. Sneed could not hang on to it.
Yet again now, that's a great job there by the Texas defense, but Jeff Grimes, the offensive coordinator, he's got to be making note now. That one was a cover two look where the corner's squatting in the flat. But these Texas corners have been very aggressive. At some point or another, they got to look to the flat, fake to the flat, and throw it up over the top.
It's going to be a 51-yard attempt for Isaiah Hankins. High snap, and it's off to the left. So Isaac Power, the holder, was able to get it done. Rodoni was off the mark, and the miss remains 14-10 here in Waco on a beautiful day. Those Who Serve brought to you by Navy Federal Credit Union. Now last year, statues of two Baylor University World War II heroes were unveiled at the plaza here at McLean Stadium. Airman John R. Kane and Marine Jack Loomis, Baylor's two Medal of Honor recipients. They were also multi-sport lettermen during their student years. A beautiful stadium. It's a great memorial they have outside in the plaza. Bijan Robinson, we haven't called his name much in this first half.
It's really amazing what Baylor's done. I mean, I'm from Dallas and grew up in Dallas, and Baylor was such an afterthought in the early 2000s. And what's been built here over the last 10 years and the success that they've experienced on the football field. There have been some high times, there have been some low times, but the commitment to football is remarkable. Baylor should be so proud of where they're at, not just as a football program, but obviously an athletic department with their championship last year in basketball as well.
Casey Thompson was fumbling around with the ball there, finally secures it, runs it, and has a lot of open space to do so, and is out towards midfield. I like the way you say that, by the way, of just your perspective of Baylor through the years. Yeah, I grew up in Dallas. You grew up in Dallas. You're one of the biggest quarterback recruits in the state of Texas. So you were a guy who was heavily recruited by all the Texas colleges, but it wasn't that Baylor, this Baylor we know now, then.
It's completely different. And I think that's what's so amazing in asking the players, too, is, you know, what are your impressions of Baylor?
As the completion to Jared Wiley.
Because all these kids have known, I mean, the guys that are now making their college choice, they know the era in which Baylor was scoring a ton of points. They know RG3. They know Baylor as a football power. And it's remarkable just how they've established that identity in the last decade.
Robinson trying to turn that corner, doesn't find much. You go back and you think about the recent stretch. Bowl eligible 10 times in the last 12 seasons, in the comparison of the college programs within the state in that span.
And it's amazing. I mean, just Texas A&M, of course, has done a great job. in the last decade as well, and have another great team this year in Texas, the team that was the preeminent power when I was growing up. I mean, the team in the state of Texas. They have certainly experienced some hard times, but it does appear with Steve Sarkisian and the commitment they've made, they're heading in the right direction.
Third and six, and Robinson doesn't find much on the right side. Dylan Doyle with the tackle as he makes it just over the 45-yard line, but they had called two plays, so they stay right on the field. Does Casey Thompson and Robinson.
See if they try to get him to jump off sides.
With a fourth and four situation. Thompson checks with his line. Shifts over Washington to the slot on the near side, fourth and four. They're going for it. Thompson has to scramble around and then unable to find the target downfield. He was looking for Xavier Worthy, and it'll be a turnover on downs.
Love the dice roll from Steve Sarkisian. Love the throw from Casey Thompson. Really love the defensive play by Walcott. How about him just selling out underneath, getting a hand on the football? As it looked like Thompson, as he kind of got flushed, he had a guy to the right side on the corner route. That's Joshua Moore. Would have loved for him to be working the right side. Unfortunately for Texas, Thompson's eyes were left, and it was an outstanding defensive play that ended that drive.
So Walcott with the pass broken up, and that was deflected at the line of scrimmage by Texas.
Well, guys, after the missed Baylor field goal, offensive coordinator Jeff Grimes got the entire offense together in a group on the sidelines. He said, we need to do two things. One, we have to get cleaner blocks to help the run game. Two, catch the football and then take the hit. If you can make guys miss it for a few extra yards, great, but you have to secure the football first. Finally, he said, settle down, refocus, and just relax.
And get their best starting field position after the turnover on downs at the 44-yard line. Ebner is able to get to that left side before he is ridden down. It was Adamora with the tackle. It was Devondre Sweat who had the pass deflected on first down, and with that, now a third down and six for this Baylor offense.
Yeah, and a big down here for Texas's defense. Your offense rolls the dice here this part of the field because they trust their defense. Defense played well up to this point. Had the one drive, but for the most part, Texas has been really solid on this side of the football. So it'd be great for this Texas defense to make their head coach right after he rolled the dice on fourth down.
Third and six. They're going to run it with Smith. And this will be close to the mark. He's going to be about a yard short, as he was dragged down by Alfred Collins.
Play there by Collins. If he doesn't make it, man. I mean, Abe Smith might have hit his head on the goalpost. There was nobody on the right side of the field. But the defender just dragging them down by the shoelaces just short set up this decision by Dave Aranda.
Well, they've had a lot of success on fourth down. Baylor leads the Big 12 with 13 fourth down conversions. That is three more than any other Big 12 team. So they're going for it on fourth and one. Out of the I formation, short pitch Smith, and Smith is stacked up. What a great surge by Texas up front on that right side. Jaron Thompson came around from that safety position. Keandre Coburn is down. That is a critical part of their defense. The big space eater in the middle of that Texas defense. So we'll take a short break with Coburn down.
Yeah, you're going to see the fullback. He actually goes in the wrong hole. He works inside. And the running back works to the outside where there's an unblocked defender. Look at Doyle work up to the inside. He whiffs. The defender makes the play. And the Longhorns make their head coach right by getting a sudden change.
Taco Bell welcomes you to the LiveMoss Student Section of the Year contest. Hashtag Student Section Sauce. To get the committee's attention, go to ESPN.com/Taco Bell. What a student section it is here at McLean Stadium. Nothing like the last time we called a Baylor game. That was at Floyd Casey. What a beautiful spot this is. Juan Davis. Fresh freshman tight end from Fort Worth.
You see Steve Sarkisian said the biggest point of emphasis throughout the bye week is focusing on keeping the gas pedal pressed. Said that there were times throughout the course of the last few weeks where in the second quarter and the third quarter, he maybe got a little too conservative. Staying aggressive is a huge point of emphasis. Let's see if he can keep the gas pedal pressed today.
Casey Thompson on second and seven as he goes to Washington. And with that reception, it will be third and short. I feel like Sark has had to be a little more psychologist over the course of the past week, right? When you talk to him, and he knows there's talents, but it's about the psychology of sustain, of pressing forward, of playing on.
He's big on the psyche and not allowing the circumstances of the game to impact your performance. The scoreboard doesn't matter. The time doesn't matter. Just win this play and stay as positive as humanly possible regardless of the outcome.
Direct snap to Roshan Johnson on third down, and it works out well as that'll move the chains. To that point, the great award-winning documentary Free Solo about the free climb up the vertical rock formation, that is what he had the team watch over the course of the past week. My players took a lot out of it in terms of the mental focus of sustaining, of keeping towards the end goal, even when it can be a daunting task. Finishing strong, unlike what they saw in the fourth quarters against Oklahoma and Oklahoma State when they squandered double-digit leads. Thompson on first down, launching to the end zone, wide open, but off to the left of Xavier Worthy. What a missed opportunity that was.
Oh my goodness, as a quarterback, these are the ones that you'll literally remember when you're 35 years old. Like, you'll think back, say, oh my goodness, I had him. And yet you throw it out of bounds. It's all part of the mechanics and the fundamentals. They're not so good from Casey Thompson's. We'll take a look in just a minute.
The anguish by which you said it seems like somebody still in their mid-30s has those nightmares.
It's one
Johnson
against
on the carry.
It's one against LSU that still gives me nightmares. And then again, here, look at his feet here. All right, there's good rush off the right-hand side. He clearly feels the pressure, but when he throws the ball, neither foot is on the ground. Both feet are in the air. Try hitting a fadeaway jumper from 50 yards, okay? It's one thing to do it from 15 feet, but to do it from 40, 45 yards, it's almost impossible to be accurate. So right there, you got to keep your feet planted. Keep your base grounded. He'll be more accurate driving the ball down the field.
Third down and six. Thompson looking for an option and finding one and spinning free is Joshua Moore. Ball came loose at the end there. Was he down? Baylor quick to jump on it. But was Joshua Moore down at the end of that play?
There's a great job there by Doyle. And Petrie picked it up. Let's take a peek. Doyle's
rolling
over the
on
top.
The field is a fumble recovered by the defense. First down, Baylor.
Ooh, it's close. As you can see, let's take a look. When does that ball start to come loose? Ooh, you see it starting to come loose just a little bit out the right-hand side. Doyle swipes at it there.
The ruling on the previous play of a fumble is under further review.
Our rules expert, John Perry, has eyes on it.
Yeah, we got eyes on knees, and where is that ball? I think it is loose prior to either knee touching the turf. I would stick with a fumble.
I think it's a stand too, John. As I look at it, it looks like those knees are just up a little bit as that ball starts to slide out to the right-hand side.
We'll be back with the results of the review after this very short break. Don't go anywhere. Review confirms that this is a fumble forced by Dylan Doyle, recovered and returned by Jalen Petrie and the Baylor Bears. So Joshua Moore fumbles inside the 20. And Gary Bohannon and the Bears offense back out there. A turnover apiece now for these two teams. Let's go to the studio to Kevin Negandhi.
Give us to Avon Smith.
Thank you. could this be the day that finally Kenneth Walker and that Heisman conversation boils over as Bohannon gets it complete to Thornton? I mean, this guy's already got 85 yards and 2 touchdowns in that rivalry game. But if that team can move their way to 8-0 with a win against number 6 and Walker goes for 100 and something more yards, that guy's been sensational.
He's been off the charts, and nobody knows about it. Obviously, the backloaded schedule for Michigan State, there's going to be plenty of statement opportunities for him down the stretch. But I feel like he has been very much under the radar in regards to the Heisman conversation.
So after the 11-yard catch by Thornton, first down. That had no chance at all. And Smith was gobbled up by Benda.
So far, Texas along the line of scrimmage has been pretty solid.
They have.
Talking about a Baylor defense, or a Baylor offense, excuse me, that has been really sound running the football and kind of keeping defenses off balance. But so far, these talented defensive linemen from Texas, they have not been pushed around. It's been impressive.
Second 13. Bohannon forced back by Coburn. And he just had to burn it. Big Keandre Coburn was penetrating. It's a guy who made a great change in his life. He cut out sweets over the summer. Lost a good amount of weight. Says he feels healthier. His nickname around the program has been Snacks, but he's, I'm going to change the kind of snacks and be a little more explosive. And he has been a difference maker for the Longhorns.
Yeah, he's added the ability to now get in the backfield in the pass rush situation. For the first few years, man, he was really an anchor in the middle of the defense. Now he can play on all three downs because of his ability to affect the quarterback.
Third and 13. Bohannon, shallow cross, and it goes nowhere because B.J. Foster, who had an interception on the second play of the game, was able to take down Thornton. Man, great job by the Texas defense.
Man, a great job at safety, too. You see B.J. Foster, they bring the corner pressure off the right-hand side. Foster rolls down into it, and he cuts off that shallow cross. Ball just slightly off target there for Gary Bohannon. Maybe the ball thrown out in front, get him running. Maybe it's a track meet, but a great play by the defense.
Isaac Powers' first punt of the day, and it's a big boomer. Oh, and it just goes in to the end zone for the touchback. 14-10, just over 3.5 minutes to play here in Waco before halftime.
College football presented by Arby's on ABC is brought to you by Duluth Trading Company. Clothing and gear designed and tested to do.
Not much better than the Friday night lights of Texas high school football. This was China Spring High School in Waco beating Robinson last night 52-21. They're 9-0. And yes, Greg, Southlake Carroll rolled. They beat Fort Worth Timber Creek last night 42-7.
As always, come on. The Dragons.
Casey Thompson, Oklahoma City High School product, as he went to Newcastle, connecting with Worthy, and Worthy's been something as a good-looking freshman, hasn't he? Katie.
Well, guys, Steve Sarkisian says he really admires the perseverance Casey Thompson has shown throughout his career. He stuck it out through the Ellinger years. He held strong when Hudson Card was named the starter at the beginning of the season, and then he capitalized on the opportunity when his time came. Sark says he values that kind of character in his starting quarterback, and Thompson told me, "I've always felt like I was good enough to be the starting quarterback at Texas, and now I'm finally getting to prove it."
Persevering. That is not uncommon in that household as he goes to Washington. They call it Thompson Strong. Of course, his father is the former Oklahoma star Charles Thompson, who was a star back in 1987, and then had his own difficulties outside of football with legal troubles as a young man. But there was a great College Game Day feature this year detailing how much Casey admires his dad, who's right there, former Oklahoma Sooner star Charles Thompson, of overcoming adversity and always staying focused and patient. They refer to it as Thompson Strong in that family. Robinson on second and 4.
And I love it too, because Casey Thompson, I mean, losing the starting job to a guy that's younger than you is gut-wrenching. And to overcome that adversity and just stay the course, thinking, hey, I'm gonna get my shot. I don't know when it's gonna come, but I'm gonna get it at some point. And then to secure the starting lineup after the Arkansas game, and now he's taken it and the offense has taken off. It's really been fun to watch this young man persevere.
Third down and five. Bijan. Boy, struggling to find anything as he just works his way to midfield. That has been a point of concentration by the Baylor front seven. The key on number five.
Yeah, I don't think many people would have guessed that Texas would have the lead and have as many points scored as Bijan Robinson has yards.
That's right.
I mean, he's got seven carries for 15 yards. One of the best backs being completely bottled up by this Baylor team. As you can see what he's done the last couple weeks against solid teams in Oklahoma and Oklahoma State. Today, Baylor, they have his number. They're going to have to find something in the second half to get their best player involved.
Dicker, who has all three specialist duties on to punt away. Ebner, the fair catch inside the 10. That gives us the opportunity to say hello to Kevin again. Look forward to that, getting us up to speed on everything happening around college football. So we have a very good one here and a very important game when it comes to the Big 12. Baylor is in position. I mean, Baylor sitting here at 6-1, thinking about a Big 12 championship appearance. And Texas, with what's happened this month, with the double-digit loss, leads lost against Oklahoma and Oklahoma State, this is a you gotta have it the way they're viewing their season. Bohannon's going to run it. And Bohannon surges ahead and gets to the 14-yard line.
If you're Baylor, you got to feel like you're actually in a pretty decent spot. I know you're going in trailing, which is never something that you want, but you weathered the early storm from the Longhorns.
Dangerous, as that route was almost jumped that time by Dunn. He tried to get out to it. 50 seconds remain. Both teams have all three timeouts, so Texas could play this to try to get a possession with a third and four pending.
And I think if you're Baylor, you can go back, say, hey, we can run the football. Both of our backs right now are averaging over 4 yards a carry. We've been pretty solid in the passing game. Just got to be a little bit more efficient on third down, but they've left some opportunities on the field if you're the Bears.
Third down and four, and Bohannon is going to get the first down. The Texas defense was looking for a stop, maybe get decent field position with the timeouts and under a minute to play, but instead Baylor is able to move the chains there. Bohannon, plenty of time to sit back, choose an option, and it's picked off by Brockemeyer. Brockemeyer with blockers in front, and Texas with the turnover, and 27 seconds left in the half, and prime field position served on a silver platter. Bohannon's second pick thrown in this first half.
Well, you're going to see cover two, and he thinks he's going to have this big old space right here. Well, what it becomes is Tampa two, which means the linebacker, the middle linebacker, is just going to drop into that empty zone. It's an easy interception from Brockemeyer. That's a poor job there by Bohannon, identifying the coverage, thinking he has a freebie, but it's actually well baited there by the Texas linebacker. Just a mistake that absolutely can't happen with this much time remaining in that part of the field.
Three timeouts remain for Texas. Thompson, 27 seconds to work with. He goes underneath as he's able to find his tight end, Cade Brewer.
And I really just don't like anything about that sequence there as Texas fires a timeout. Either you're going to try to steal some points or you're not. It
right.
Felt like they were kind of in no man's land.
On the third and four when they had the quarterback run, you
right.
Figured perhaps that was not the game plan.
Right. There's 30 seconds left, and you're still 40 yards away from potential field goal range. I don't like the decision there. I don't like putting your quarterback in that spot. Your quarterback, ultimately, though, he's got to make you right. I mean, he can't make a costly mistake like that and now put Texas on the fringe of field goal range. You're basically just wrapping up a present. And with Dicker for Texas, who's obviously got plenty of range and plenty of ability. I mean, you're basically just gift wrapping them a free 3 points at the end of the half.
Second and five. Thompson to the end zone and incomplete. Joshua Moore could not hold on. 13 seconds remain and a third and five.
Oh my goodness, it's a good throw. Tight coverage, you squeeze it in between the two defenders and Thompson loves it until he doesn't. Oh man.
Everybody thought it was going to be two arms up.
Oh, the reaction. We've had a missed throw from Thompson and a drop. Texas has left some points on the field here in the first half.
And we've had two. One was thrown to the outside, and one was flat out dropped. Third and five, 13 seconds left in the half. Two timeouts remain. Thompson, that is picked off. How dangerous. Woods on the return. Cuts to the outside. And he's taken down with 2 seconds remaining. JT Woods with the interception of Casey Thompson. Moments ago, Texas had a should have been seven. Moments later, it's JT Woods going the other way.
And you're going to see Apu Aika, number 62, applying the pressure, forces the ball out of Casey Thompson's hands just a little bit too quick. Ball's just ever so slightly off the mark. It leads to the tip, but it's got to be caught. That's two consecutive plays now from Joshua Moore, in which he has got to catch the football. I mean, that, as you can see his reaction too, he is frustrated on the sideline. Understandably so, man. You got to help your quarterback out.
And now Bohannon will take a shot. Going to launch it to the end zone. A lot of traffic, and it hits the ground harmlessly. Well, that was a wild first half, wasn't it? When Texas did leave points out there on the field. And then JT Woods closed things down. Capital One Halftime Report is still to come after these messages. Outside McLean Stadium, Riverside, as we welcome you back to ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by Arby's. We had a 14-10 score at the end of the first quarter, and that was the score at halftime as well because of two missed opportunities by Texas. Both teams had a drive with a turnover on downs, but 14-10 Longhorns. Here's Katie with Sark moments ago.
Offensively, what do you need to see from that group in the next half?
Well, we got to catch the ball, you know, we got to hold on to the ball. We have some opportunities. We got to hold on to it. We got to make our plays when they're there.
How do you get the run game going?
Well, we got to stick to it. They're committed to trying to stop it, so we got to continue to play action pass if that's how they're going to play.
How do you get the run game going? That question asked because Bijan Robinson has 7 carries for only 15 yards. Instead, it has been Casey Thompson leading the way. He's 12 of 16, 156 yards, and 2 touchdowns. Texas will get the ball to start this second half. Critical game for the Longhorns after the October of the game against Oklahoma and Oklahoma State when they had the big leads, when they had good starts like they've had today, and then gave way. Jamison and Johnson hoping to get an opportunity of the Rauschenberg return. So Casey Thompson has the 2 touchdown passes, but there was the 1 throw to the outside to a wide open receiver. There was the 1 where there was a drop, and then just before the half, the interception.
Yeah, and it really was a half that Texas did a lot of really nice things. We're really good on the game, really offensively, did a really good job spreading the ball around, even though their best playmaker really hasn't gotten going. So Texas had to have gone to a halftime feeling as though, man, this lead could have been significantly wider. So Baylor's also got to kind of be counting their blessings a little too. They've done exactly what they want to do in holding Bijan Robinson in check, and you know they're going to get a heavy dose of him in the second half.
Robinson, who averages 132 rushing yards per game, just 15 so far today. Thompson starts off the second half with a completion as he gets it to Xavier Worthy. Xavier Worthy who had that 63-yard touchdown in the first half.
Yeah, he's special, man. And something to keep in mind, too, is Texas is throwing it, working this direction of the field. That sun is directly behind Casey Thompson. And that sun, especially on downfield throws, could have an effect on the wide receivers. See those shadows working from right to left. So let's see if Texas sees the ball well in this drive.
Robinson, again, a lot of traffic on the inside. Ika clogging things up. Saturday Night Football is presented by Capital One. Penn State taking on number 5 Ohio State. That is 7:30 Eastern on ABC. C.J. Stroud has really blossomed with what he's been able to do as the quarterback at Ohio State. 2nd and 6, and Robinson cuts it back, and he's going to be just a yard short of that line to gain. It'll be 3rd and a long 1.
Big part of what's been Baylor's plan is they've really done a good job leveraging the run game and just keeping things inside and keeping Bijan Robinson bottled up. They've also done a really good job too throughout the course of the first 30 minutes of tackling Bijan Robinson in open space, just like right there as Bijan kind of lost his footing.
Third and one, Robinson. Boy, it is a fight to find anything, and based on that spot, he's going to be short, as that was Bernard, Terrell Bernard, making the tackle. He's the leader of the defense and a young man who's overcome a lot of injuries he's dealt with in his career.
Yeah, great job by him. They're filling from the backside, and Texas, they went for a similar spot of the field in the first half. Be surprised if that wasn't the play again. They now bring in Roshan Johnson, number 2. Could go with a direct snap to him, but he'll line up in a traditional wide receiver spot.
4th down and 1. And he comes under center, does Roshan Johnson. And they're going to use a timeout. So he brings in the second back, tried to hard count it under center, and then uses the timeout. Take a short break and get you right back here to Waco. Glad you're with us watching the Big 12 on ESPN. 4th down and 1 off of the timeout. Roshan Johnson and Bijan Robinson in the backfield together. Johnson lined up as the quarterback in the shotgun. This is off of the timeout. And he will carry it himself for a first down. So Roshan Johnson is one of the leaders of the locker room. Junior comes in and moves the chains for Sark.
Yeah, and a good job there by Roshan. Down in distance, straight ahead. Nothing fancy about that run. Right here, if I'm Sark, I'm taking a shot. I'm trying to take a shot over the top, see if I can't catch this Baylor defense off guard.
Offense number 8, 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
And that's Worthy, the freshman receiver. Start of a big day of college football. Really intriguing to see what happens with Ole Miss and Auburn tonight. That's coming up on ESPN.
That's a good one. I'm real interested to see what Auburn does. Auburn, of course, coming off a bye. Difficult stretch here in the final few weeks of the season.
1st and 15 with Robinson after the penalty. Now Walcott with the tackle.
I think there's got to be more of that right there, Joe. I mean, you look at Bijan Robinson, you want to get him to the edge. I mean, he's so powerful, so good in the open field. I need to get him outside the tackles, because right now between the tackles, Siaki Aika and those guys haven't given up much.
Incomplete, as he was looking on an in-cutting route to Joshua Moore. And he was defended by Kalen Barnes.
Right here, this spot of the field. So you really have 2 downs to get it. I mean, Sark just went for it on 4th and short 5 or 6 yards ago. So you got to think, as a play caller, make this 4th down more manageable. You can pick up 5 or 6, it's no problem, because you're going to definitely stay aggressive. You just did on the last opportunity that presented itself.
From the Baylor 41, As Robinson heads out to the top of your screen, third down and eight. Thompson steps up in the pocket and then goes over the middle and is able to get it complete inside the 20-yard line. He goes to Marcus Washington.
And nice job there, too, by Thompson. Stepping up in the pocket. There was a decent presence on the right side. Steps up, keeps his eyes downfield, and throws a strike. A really good job there by Thompson, attacking the line of scrimmage and allowing those receivers to uncover.
22 yards to Washington. Jordan Whittington, one of the starting receivers, is out injured, had surgery, so Washington getting more playing time. And this is Brewer, and he is upended. He went flying after he was chopped down and cut down by Walken. 10 yards on the reception to Cade Brewer. Actually going to mark it just inches short. I'm going to say 9.5 yards after that flip.
How about it? Brewer going vertical. And Walcott delivering the blow.
Second and less than one. Johnson testing the right side, and it'll be first and goal, Texas.
And they've found something with that run where they hand it off and they try to capture the edge of this Baylor defense. You can expect Sark to continue to just work that. He finds a play that's effective. He'll run it over and over and over again until you adjust. So the challenge will be on Dave Aranda and his defensive coordinator, Ron Roberts, to find an answer for that perimeter run.
First and goal. Thompson clearly affected by all the traffic as Bernard was coming in on him.
Eye on these tight ends down here too if you're Baylor. So they got some length at tight end with Jared Wiley, who's 6'7" down here in the tight end spot on the left.
Second and goal, Robinson. And the third and goal from the 5-yard line.
In this part of the field, length is your friend. It's always obviously beneficial, but as the windows condense, sometimes you just have to throw it high in the back of the end zone, and the guys that are usually best at being able to snag those are those guys with great length. So always love trying to find tight ends in this spot on the field.
What can Casey Thompson find here? Robinson out of the backfield, and they are going to mark him at the 1-yard line. He was cut down by Barnes at the last possible moment, and he could only stretch out to the one.
So close, but a good spot as you see that left arm go down there for Bijan Robinson.
Fourth and goal.
Big number 99 in the ball game for the Texas Longhorns, and big number 90, Byron Murphy at fullback.
And Robinson takes it in. His 11th rushing touchdown of the year. A 10-game touchdown scoring streak now for Bijan Robinson. Jerry, his grandmother, family out here in Waco to celebrate Bijan.
How about that opening drive from the Texas Longhorns? 14 plays, methodical, right down the field with some nice conversions. Just an excellent job working their way against a defense that wasn't giving up much. They earned every one of those 75 yards.
2 for 2 on fourth down to get it done on that 14-play drive. Jerry says, I'm going to record that for some family history. Hey, we got you set with Sunday NFL Countdown, the stories behind the NFL's most unusual superstitions. Plus, they go one-on-one with Patrick Mahomes. That's 10 a.m. Eastern on ESPN. Fourth down touchdown run moments ago by Bijan Robinson has it 21-10. Texas on top. Greg, they had 28 total plays in the first half. They just had 14 on their first drive of this second half alone. Katie, what did Baylor coach Dave Aranda have to say to you?
Well, he always wants his team to play green, as in green means go. He wants guys confident and playing fast. He felt like in the first half, they were a bit yellow, hesitant, unsure of themselves. He also thought that Texas's defensive schemes in the first half spooked Gary early, and then he was plagued with trying to be too perfect to close out the second half. He just wants them to settle in and find their rhythm offensively, and they're going to need to fast, given how Texas just opened up the second half.
See if they can get that rhythm here with their first possession of this second half. Gary Bohannon was 10 of 20 and threw two interceptions in the first half. Play action to open up the second half as he's pressured and gets it complete and does so to Thornton. And Thornton out to the 49-yard line. So it's a very good start for Baylor with a 23-yard reception to Thornton.
And I love the way, obviously, as an injured Longhorn, there, that's Josh Thompson, one of their defensive backs. Hopefully he's okay. But I love the start there from Jeff Grimes with the play call. Get your quarterback moving. Work him into the second half. Get him started with a nice, easy completion.
We'll be back in 10 seconds. Now a look from Ram Trucks.
Ram Trucks, built to serve.
Jeff Grimes looking into that play sheet. First down near midfield. Abram Smith, he will get the work. Holds on to the ball. Texas tried to strip it away, crossing midfield. 2 weeks ago, he went to work, did Abram Smith, against BYU. Had career highs with 27 carries, went for 188 yards, had three touchdowns. It's been a big part of the success that Baylor has had to get themselves to 6-1.
He had a nice first half, too. I mean, Baylor has what they want offensively. Just can't have those critical mistakes from their quarterback with a couple interceptions.
Bohannon on second and six. Going up for it and getting it is Sneed. And this is the drive that Baylor needs. They've got to respond, and Sneed helps them with a 24-yard reception.
A great job stepping up, too. Watch Gary Bohannon. There's presence, and he feels it, steps up. Nice, calm, cool, and collected. He clearly feels Brennan Schooler coming up behind him, steps into the throw a little high, but a great catch there by his wide receiver, Snead.
Limited action before this season for Bohannon, but you can see how much his hard work has paid off. Abram Smith will work it to just inside the 20-yard line.
Well, guys, during spring practice, Jeff Grimes says he was frustrated with the run game. He said the running backs just weren't running with the type of toughness needed for this offense. He then voiced those frustrations with the staff, and someone said, well, have you ever seen Abram Smith run the football? Grimes said no, he didn't know the backstory. So he went to Ron Roberts and then Aranda, and the next day Smith ran the ball eight times at practice. Grimes said, that's all I needed to see. Right away, I knew he was the guy I was looking for, and they stuck with it ever since.
He's number three in the Big 12 in rushing yards per game since that decision. Second and four. Bohannon looked like he was going to run, then threw it as Overshown was coming in right on him.
Whew, this one was close. A great play by Overshown going up and getting a hand on Gary Bohannon's arm, because if you see it, I mean, he's going to hit Ebner for a walk-in touchdown right down the middle. That's a really nice design. As that linebacker commits, you try to go up and over the top, almost like a jump pass from back in the day, but a good job by the Texas defender.
I mean, Overshown just saved him 7 points, no doubt about it. Third down and four. And Ebner can't find anything. Agofu with the tackle right at the line of scrimmage.
No hesitation here from Dave Aranda. Leaving the offense on the field, not taking the points. A little surprised. Obviously had the missed field goal earlier and a young kicker nonetheless. But, man, he'd love to just take the points after what's been a pretty positive opening drive of the second half.
Fourth down and five. 6 minutes to go here in the third, and Baylor's going for it. Fourth and five. Shallow cross, they get it. And it'll be first and goal. R.J. Sneed was able to jump on the ball, but they pick up the first down on the pass from Bohannon to Sneed.
Man, gutsy play call there, and a beautiful throw. Easy slant. You have Sneed work in the middle of the field. That middle linebacker pushes to the three receiver side in the empty formation. Just stealing right over the middle of the ball, and great execution from Baylor on the conversion.
And now what do you do with it? Abram Smith. Not much is the answer. As once again that front of Texas is able to get to him. Byron Murphy and the rest of them collapsing on Smith. Second and goal.
Both drives. One by Texas, couple fourth down conversions. Here now Baylor with a fourth down conversion of their own. These nice adjustments that have been made so far by the offensive staff of both Baylor and the Longhorns. Anytime you have opening drive, this one's eight plays. Texas had a 14-play drive. I mean, I think those coaches knew what they were doing at halftime. My goodness.
A lot of window dressing here on second and goal. Smith comes back into the backfield. They run Bohannon with blockers in front and into the end zone. Gary Bohannon. Felt like a had to have it kind of drive for Baylor. That's how they treated it. Convert the fourth down, and then Bohannon takes it in.
I love the pin and pull. That's exactly what Baylor tries to do here, and it's a thing of beauty. You're able to pin that guy on the end of the line of scrimmage, and then you have blockers out in front. Bohannon makes the guy miss, and he finds Pater. Beautiful execution from the Bears.
Those down blocks then got the big road grader going. It was Xavier Newman Johnson. There's the big guy who paved it for Bohannon.
List for the Mannings tonight.
You've reached Peyton and Eli. Leave a message.
This is Liam Neeson. I have a very particular set of skills, none of which involves watching game film. Watch Peyton and Eli. You never know who will drop by.
That is so good. I mean, I could listen to that all day. Monday Night Football, you got Giants, Chiefs, 8 Eastern on ESPN. Monday Night Countdown will get you started at 6 Eastern. Well, Baylor just got their second half started just the way they needed to. Gary Bohannon had a 6-yard touchdown run. Of course, it has been a great turnaround for Baylor here in Waco. You think Waco and renovations, Chip and Joanna Gaines, well, they're not the only renovation experts, because Baylor 2017, they lost 11 games. A year later, Matt Rhule and the Bears win 11 games, go to the Sugar Bowl. 2020, they went 2-7 in Dave Aranda's first year, now 6-1. It's all about vintage barn doors, and shiplap is so in, Greg.
Very much, yes.
Do you need a sunken farm sink? Do you need one of those?
Farmhouse chic.
Farmhouse chic here in Waco. Chip and Joanna with a fixer-upper, and Dave Aranda with a quick fixer-upper, turning around Baylor in just 1 year. Casey Thompson on first down, nearly tripped up, but then able to make a move, and look at this! It's a big gainer for Casey Thompson out to midfield. 25-yard run for Thompson.
Well, he's not the fastest guy in the world, but my goodness, how about this move in the open field? Little, yeah! He gets Terrell Bernard, just jukes him out of his shoes.
Now Bijan Robinson tackled for a loss as Bernard and McVay take down Bijan Robinson.
I'll tell you what, I can't say enough about what Baylor is currently doing to one of the best running backs in college football. I mean, they are totally keyed in on him. As soon as he touches the football, they are swarming and doing a great job too on the edges and taking him down in space.
Second and 14. Thompson. Incomplete. He was trying to get it to Joshua Moore. Kevin, what's up, my man? Oh, Boog's all over it.
Boog's money, he can do farmhouse chic. Change it the next week, man.
Third and 14. What does Thompson have? Incomplete, well beyond Joshua Moore.
Great job there by the Baylor defense. Pressuring the quarterback, bringing a little bit of heat and starting to impact there at the line of scrimmage too. Of course, as you take a look at Ron Roberts, him and Dave Aranda, long history together. Love the glasses too, it's just awesome, man. I really have enjoyed watching their performance this year, and they're putting on a little bit of a clinic here at times in this game.
Oh, Dicker, they came right in on him. He hit the deck, but somehow the punt went downfield. That seemed like it was partially blocked that
there's
time.
There's no foul for roughing the kicker. The ball was tipped.
It was, and that's why there's no roughing the kicker.
I mean, how does this not get blocked? I mean, it felt like he could almost tackle Dicker as he punted it. It just goes right underneath him. He was almost too far. It's R.J. Sneed who's making the play. And, man, if you're a punter, Joe, that's not what you like. Not from your shield right in front of you.
You know what I love, though, is having your star speed starting receiver coming straight in through the A-gap against that shield. But that shield's got to hold up in a spot like that.
I mean, I got to give Dicker credit. I mean, he didn't flinch.
Nope.
And just wore it, got right back up as if it was nothing.
He's 6'1", 216 pounds, and a veteran guy. And a timeout is going to be called by Texas. That is their second timeout exhausted. Let's go back to the studio, Kevin. Whoa! That was a shot fired.
Oh, my gosh. I'm going to dunk on Booger next time I see him. I'm going to dunk on him.
College football rankings are brought to you by PlayStation.
Yeah, as you can see, obviously Georgia and Florida today here at 3:30. Looking forward to that game, that's for sure. Georgia, they've been world beaters. I mean, there's no denying that. Florida's a capable opponent coming off a bye. I'd be surprised if Florida didn't have a good plan. Of course, right now, Iowa struggling on the road at Wisconsin, who's turned things around, and it appears as though Michigan in prime spot to take care of business against their rivals right now as they lead by 9.
By the way, we are being told that they are reviewing to see if indeed the ball was partially blocked on that punt. Greg, listen, we look at those rankings, and I brought this up a couple weeks ago as we take a look here. Sneed was coming in.
The funny thing is I don't think looking at it is the best way to find out.
No, the ball.
I would listen to it.
Yep.
Because you can hear the ta-da, if the ball hits the foot and the player. And it sounded to me like the ball was, in fact, tipped.
Let's listen to it. Here's a natural sound from it. Yes. You hear the double contact. You hear the contact on the foot and then the contact with the hand.
Correct. That's how I would identify it.
And you could also see by the ball flight, by the way. That ball had no chance of being turned over. It was not struck in the normal way that would produce the normal flight of a punt. As they look that over, here it is again. As Sneed, this play should stand as it was ruled on the field.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands. The ball is tipped, first down.
Yep. Anyways, just to further the conversation when we put up those rankings, I brought up a couple weeks ago to you, I'll say it again, we got the college football playoff rankings coming out in a few days here. I think they're going to look very different than what we've known the AP rankings to be.
Very much so. And I think it's very dependent. Michigan, of course, in a prime spot. I'm most interested, though, when the rankings come out on Tuesday, where is Oregon and where is Ohio State? Because Ohio State, if we're going based exclusively on the eye test,
yes,
has looked fantastic and has a pretty solid resume, especially if they win tonight. But Oregon won the head-to-head. And Oregon, while they haven't passed the eye test, should be ahead of Ohio State based on what they've accomplished, considering they have the head-to-head win.
Bohannon overthrows Fleeks. College Football Playoff Top 25 show is presented by Allstate. First College Football Playoff rankings. These are the way you predict things will be.
This is how I'd have it. And while Oklahoma and Cincinnati have had some up and down performances, they're undefeated. Alabama has the win against Ole Miss. Alabama's resume is excellent. Obviously, the loss against Texas A&M, very difficult, obviously, to put ahead of an unranked, an undefeated team. But with the ups and downs we've seen from Cincinnati and Oklahoma, I just have to have the Tide in front.
Ebner trying to keep his balance out to the 29-yard line. Go to ESPN.com/AllstatePlayoffPredictor to check out your team's chances to make the College Football Playoff. Again, the reveal happens Tuesday night. Third down and one. Smith looking to move the chains, and he will. Rockermeyer had the tackle. Rockermeyer had an interception before halftime earlier today.
It's going to be interesting also to see where Baylor's going to be ranked. If they can win today, obviously, 7-1 with some pretty impressive victories, they're going to be in the mix as well. It's going to be tough to get within striking distance of the playoff. But you beat Oklahoma a couple times. I mean, my goodness, anything's possible for these Baylor Bears.
Yeah, I mean, it's all about making the Big 12 championship game and playing for a championship. And as Smith continues to get more work, a lot of stuff is going to clean itself up, especially with what's happening in the Big 10.
So interesting watching this Baylor team and thinking back to when they were at their heyday, you know, in that 2013-14, 11-12, 13-14, the era where they were just airing it out. To see them huddle is almost uncomfortable for me.
That's right.
Watching them, they're playing slow. It's not used to it, that's for sure.
Bohannon on 2nd and 6. That was low, intended for Ben Sims.
Pass intended for Ben Sims.
And that one just off the mark there for Gary Bohannon, one that had Sims open. Throw that he's got to make just died on him a little bit as it reached his intended target.
Third and six. Quickly to the outside, right at the sticks is Thornton. And they are ruling that a catch. They said he went down, got his hands underneath it, and Thornton will give Baylor a first down.
And if I'm Baylor, I'd go fast. Because this ball, they're obviously going to take a look at it. Did he secure it? It's close. This is a good angle
previous
here.
Previous play is under further review. Rolling on field was a catch.
Yeah, it looks like his hands are underneath it. They'll take a peek at this, but I'd be surprised, Tess, if this call was overturned. I think that's a catch. A good job, too, there by Thornton, knowing how far he needed to go to pick up the first down. Sometimes receivers are in such a rush to get open. They're in such a rush to get to where they need to go that they'll often cut that route just a little bit short. How often do you see a bang-bang play? The next thing you know, it's 4th and 1. That time, Thornton took his time, got his depth, and secured the catch. Great play by the wide receiver.
And John Perry, I think we got a really good look at this, don't we?
We do. Thanks to the great camera work. I mean, this is outstanding camera work. Great call. I see why it goes catch. The thing I don't see is the ball move up through the body. So I do like it as a stands with a catch.
You know, John brings up a great point. You know, replay is only as good as the camera operators and the replay folks that we have in the production truck can be. And you see the zoom in there. And excellent look that time to get that shot. Now, while they look that over, it is time for our Aflac trivia question. This Baylor team was down 21-10 not long ago. One of four Power 5 teams ranked in the top 25 in scoring offense and scoring defense. And we ask who are there are three teams.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands as a catch. First down.
So Baylor balanced this year with their success in scoring offense and scoring defense, ranking in the top 25. Who are the other three? There are four in college football. Got a stab at it, Greg?
I'm going to say Georgia.
Well, defensively, no doubt about it, right?
I feel fairly confident their defense is ranked in the top 25, just whether or not. Wow, how about Michigan? Michigan, offensively, know they've been great on defense.
Well, and they don't really pass the ball that much.
And then Ohio State, I'm shocked with all their struggles and all the conversation about how bad their defense has been, but they've turned it around a little bit.
Ebner on the carry on first down. And we'll get to the outside and then lower that shoulder is Treston Ebner, the fifth-year guy who took advantage of the extra COVID year. Very well respected in the program. Do it all kind of back. He's been great in the return game, out of the backfield, all-purpose yardage kind of guy. Second and four, Bohannon makes the would-be tackler miss and then drives ahead past midfield and gets the first down.
Great athleticism there from Gary Bohannon. Ogofu had him there on the edge in the backfield, but he makes a miss and makes a good, smart decision. Instead of trying to force it to one of his receivers downfield, take it yourself and pick up the first down.
Final half minute of this third quarter. To the outside and complete to Drew Estrada, who left the Ivy League for the Big 12. Transferred to Baylor this year from Dartmouth. He was up there playing for Buddy Tevens, excellent coach at Dartmouth, and is equally a great guy.
Baylor snaps it one more time before the end of the quarter.
And we will hit zeros. Robinson had the fourth down touchdown to open up this second half for Texas. Baylor was down 11. And they put together a good drive to come back with Bohannon the touchdown. And we have an interesting one headed to the fourth quarter as college football presented by Arby's returns after this message and a word from our ABC stations. ESPN College Football on ABC presented by Arby's as we start the fourth quarter. And I think that's Lady. Joy and Lady are the two Bears here at Baylor. As their team trails by four. Bohannon downfield strike and wide open is Ben Sims. ...28 yards to Sims to start this fourth quarter. Bohannon to the other side. And inside the 10-yard line is R.J. Sneed. Boy, that Sims play sparked them.
I love this. You get the full design. All the flow is this way. And he has worked the tight end out the back door. Just an awesome design. It's so difficult to defend because all the Texas defenders are thinking full boot action. He's rolling to his right. Let's get over the top. And then in comes Sims right around the backside. Very accurate throw there too from Bohannon. Just an excellent call and great execution by the Bears.
So well designed, wasn't it? Second and three. Smith straight ahead. Smith. It'll be first and goal. Baylor looking to take the lead.
And if I were Baylor, I got Texas on my heels, man. I would have snapped it twice by now. I mean, same play, right to it immediately. Now you just allowed Texas to sub, and they have fresh bodies along their defensive line.
First and goal. Smith looking for something, and he can only get maybe to the 1 yard line. Is that left side of that defensive line collapsed with a Jomo.
Doyle coming in with the tackle.
Doyle now coming
Doyle
in.
Coming in, excuse me, at fullback.
Yeah. Now he's the guy that got thrown a couple bones last time out. They threw him one, they handed him one off. We asked Jeff Grimes how deep that playbook goes to feature number five.
He's a starting linebacker, but he's been having success at fullback. Offset with Smith in the backfield on second and goal. And instead, they come around with the tight end. Ben Sims takes it in. And Baylor's first lead since they were up 10-7 late in the first quarter. This is all too familiar for Texas in the month of October. So Ben Sims had the big reception and then had this.
I love this because you basically are just selling everything going this way. Meanwhile, he's motioning back. You hand it off very quickly. Look at all those Texas jerseys. They're all trying to jump leverage, and that's just taking advantage of the misdirection. Just an excellent call there and beautiful design. You have a blocker out in front. He whiffs, but it didn't matter as Baylor punches it in for another touchdown. I just really like that design on the goal line when Texas is selling out completely against the strong side run.
We mentioned the constant theme, the familiarity with this against Oklahoma. They squandered a 21-point advantage in the Red River Showdown. That went 55-48 the other way. And then in the next game against Oklahoma State, they had a 14-point lead in the second quarter. They were outscored 29-7 the rest of the game. It was 21-10 here. Baylor was trailing by double digits. And now they have the lead in the fourth quarter. Kevin? Baylor will see Oklahoma on November 13th. Thompson gonna check it down to Washington. So remember we had the conversation earlier about the psychology that Coach Sark has been trying to instill, that he had them watch the inspirational documentary Free Solo. These are the moments. This is the time and the score on the scoreboard where you see the impact that it has as the strike for a completion goes to Washington. But he's trying to get them to think differently about sustaining and finishing.
Yeah, and a great opportunity for their offense now to respond. I mean, all week last week, as they looked in the mirror, no opponent, they talked about finishing, finishing, finishing. And not allowing the circumstances in the game to dictate how you perform. Great opportunity to change the narrative on this team right now with this drive offensively.
Thompson goes for 4 yards there. Petrie with the tackle. Petrie had the fumble recovery earlier today.
He's excellent. I love watching Petrie play. So instinctive, has a great feel for the game.
He says, well, I feel like wolves out there, hungry to eat. Goes to the tight end Wiley, the big 6'7" target, and that will give Texas a first down. 7-yard reception by Jared Wiley. Thompson in the foreground. Sark, one of the great offensive minds of the sport, in the background.
I might take a shot here if I'm Sark. Plus territory, big heavy play action. See if you can throw it over Baylor's head.
There's the play action. Pressure came. Ball came loose and Thompson had a fall on it, and it was Jalen Petrie. What do you say about that mentality? To be hungry, to make the big play, to set the tone, to be the wolf out there starving to eat. He was right there, wasn't he?
That's a game changer. I mean, right here, this is a Laffer touchdown. I mean, wide open, and Petrie makes the play. I mean, look at him, wide open. I mean, there's nobody covering Marcus Washington down the field. Instead, Petrie makes the sack, strips the ball. That's how you end up on the Thorpe Award list. I mean, he's one of the best in the business and showed it right there.
Can you believe the missed opportunities from Texas today of downfield big plays just left there? Thompson, what a great job going up and getting that football by Wiley. It was second and 16 and 10-yard reception. It'll be third medium here, third about six.
How about the psyche there from Casey Thompson? I mean, the response after what was a disastrous first down play. Throws a strike over the middle to make it third and manageable and likely four down territory for the Longhorn offense.
10 minutes to play in the game. They were up 11. Now they trail three to number 16. There was movement as Baylor showed a little pressure.
False start. Offense. Number 67, 5-yard penalty. Still third down.
And you're going to see Amada just slide a little bit, big fella at right guard, as the Baylor defense, Ika slid down. He slid with him.
When 361 pounds starts leaning one way, it's tough to get it going the other.
No doubt about it. And Baylor keeping a clean sheet yet again. How many straight quarters from Baylor without a penalty?
That is incredible. First time in program history, last game without a penalty. They don't have one today. Third down and 11. Thompson extending the play. Downfield wobbler is incomplete. Washington had a shot at it. But Christian Morgan was there defensively to break it up.
And that was a great job applying the pressure as you see Doyle. And man, good pass breakups. It looked like Washington had a chance there. Gets both hands on the ball. But instead, it's knocked down. Great play there from Baylor's defense.
This is a fake. Cameron Dicker is running for it on fourth and 11. The sixth fourth down attempt of the game, and we get a turnover on downs with the senior punter deciding to do that. Sark is trying to keep it positive. Sometimes the punters have the green light if they feel it and see it. Dicker felt he did. He came nowhere close.
As you see, Griffin speaks. He was on that punt, return, block, safe team. They made a great play there on Dicker that we'll show you in just a moment.
So Baylor takes over after the failed fourth down, tackling the Texas punter on a fourth and 11.
And it's a bad decision by the punter. I mean, they literally are spying. Watch speaks. He's spying the punter. As the punter drifts, he drifts with him and just keeps his eyes on him the entire time. So there's really nothing at that point that Dicker would like. I mean, still have the option to kick it. He's got to make a better decision there. Even if a fake was called or it's green lit by the coaching staff, you got to let it override with your decision.
Second and seven. There's Ebner. Good run on second and seven inside the 35. By the way, the tackle on that fourth down play on special teams by Baylor was by Byron Hanspar Jr., number 25, the son of the former unanimous All-American, the former Dope Walker Award winner at Texas Tech back in 1996, Byron Sr.
This is a massive drive for Texas's defense, by the way. Massive. Absolutely have to force a field goal.
Ebner just went for 18 yards. And now the short pitch to Smith. And Smith spins out of it. And Smith inside the 15, looking for the corner, and gets it. Touchdown, Bears. Keandre Coburn whipped at the line of scrimmage. And Smith sped off for 32 yards and a score.
How about the running back? Just a few months ago, he was playing linebacker. Didn't look like a linebacker there as he finds the corner of the end zone after what was a wonderful effort at the line of scrimmage.
It's the big play Bears getting the best of Sark and the Horns. That was their seventh play over 20 yards. They trailed by double digits. Now they're up double digits here at home. Thank you very much. You two are very busy as the day goes on, eventually with Ohio State and Penn State. The Baylor offense has been very busy as well. Katie.
Well, Greg, you asked Abe Smith just yesterday which position he liked more, linebacker or running back, and he said, well, he loved playing linebacker. The feeling of being in the end zone when you score a touchdown, Smith says there's no better feeling than that. He said an interception, yeah, it's awesome. But hearing the roar of the crowd when you run across the goal line, he said it's something you feel throughout your entire body. It's electric, and this crowd here at McLean Stadium was electric as well.
It's awesome, too. I mean, I love it, too. I mean, to go to a guy that's in his senior year and say, hey, man, can you switch sides of the ball? That's not easy, and I'm just amazed talking to Dave Aranda and this Baylor staff at just how mature their football team. A lot of veteran players, great leadership, no selfishness, and Abe Smith, a perfect example of that.
John Robinson out to the 29-yard line. Yeah, I got a chuckle. We were visiting with Smith yesterday. He said, you know, transition from linebacker to running back. He said, my mom, Rosie, said, hey, I put all this effort into learning all about playing linebacker, the nuances of what you do as a linebacker, and now you're going back to running back again? I was just learning how you, I watch you playing linebacker. Well, he has been a sensational running back. Second and six. Thompson, that looked like it may have been deflected at the line of scrimmage. A flag comes down as he was trying to get it to Worthy. Burns had coverage on Worthy. If this ball was tipped, there wouldn't be. It would affect the defensive call.
Yeah, and I think it did get tipped. I think Siaki Ika, the defensive tackle, tipped the ball at the line of scrimmage.
Part of the pass. Holding. Defense number 12. 10-yard penalty and an automatic first down.
Not when it comes to that, though. First penalty of the game on Baylor. Think about that. With 7.5 minutes to play, and that is the first penalty of the game on Baylor, and they're coming off a penalty-free win against BYU. That was the first penalty-free game in program history. So they went 7.5 quarters. Thompson. And this is past midfield and complete to Washington, who is getting a more significant role in the absence of Jordan Whittington. Quick to the line and quick into the hands of Bijan Robinson. And Robinson, good leg drive to the 39-yard line. It was a 9-yard run by Robinson.
If I'm Texas, I'm calling that exact same play over and over again.
Here's Worthy. as Worthy is able to scoot out at the 29. JT Woods on top of him there.
Yeah, I would tempo like crazy if I were Texas. I mean, this is a Baylor team that is very good in their front line, but they don't have a ton of depth, not a ridiculous amount of depth, but they can really just roll guys in and out. So I would use tempo to my advantage and challenge them whether or not they're fatigued.
6.5 to play, trailing by 10, incomplete. He was looking for Washington on the slant.
Marcus Washington, JT Woods on the coverage. Second down.
You got to think too, at some point Sark's going to draw something up that gets Xavier Worthy, their excellent freshman wide receiver. They got to find a one-on-one for him. Yeah, he's drawing a tough matchup because right now it looks like Baylor's very aware of that possibility as well.
Thompson gets it complete to the 15-yard line to Joshua Moore.
Pass complete to Joshua Moore.
Moore had the touchdown that opened up the game. Also had a fumble inside the 20, one of those missed opportunities that Texas is hoping they don't regret when they look back at this game. Thompson was hit as he threw it, and it fluttered to the ground as Terrell Bernard came in on Casey Thompson.
That was just a good job of overloading the protection. I mean, unblocked here off the edge, and he's going to deliver the blow. Nobody's blocking him. You see the offensive line slide down to take care of the internal pressure. Your quarterback, you got to beat that hot defender. And Thompson barely did so.
Roshan Johnson takes the direct snap, and he will run straight ahead. He did this with success in the first half on a fourth down, and he's able to get it inside the 10-yard line.
I would just stick with that. I mean, obviously, two-score game. Time is of the essence because you had to burn a timeout earlier. Have plenty of time. Don't need to be warp speed. I'm still trying to figure out why Texas is not utilizing some of their tempo. They've used it with some success at times throughout this drive.
Clock counting down to 5.5 minutes to play. Third and four. And it'll be fourth down from there as Doyle makes the tackle on Robinson.
Obviously not the result that Texas wanted, but Sark wisely opting to take the field goal here to make it a one-score game.
Cameron Dicker trots out there. Today, he became the all-time leader in scoring among Texas place kickers, 359 career points. And with this effort right here, the 27-yard field goal, it brings us to a touchdown margin. With 4:40 to play, it's number 16, up by 7 now.
College football on ABC is presented by Arby's. We have the meat.
Greg, this is the silobration. Silobration, because you know the Fixer Upper stars Chip and Joanna, the Magnolia Market, they have the famous landmark silo. So they have this huge celebration here in Waco this weekend. And that's what's going on down the street. They're looking for a celebration here to try to get to 7-1 with a win over Texas. Texas just had the field goal to cut it to 7. Ebner on the return. And he struggles to make it to the 15. Hardest working player is brought to you by Duluth Trading Company.
Well, let's give it to the big fellas.
Oh, I like this.
Because they have three different guys that have reached the end zone.
The whole O-line you're giving it to?
Everyone.
I love it.
I don't want to single them out. I don't play favorites for the big boys, that's for sure. And it's been amazing. They've done a great job today. No sacks allowed. They have three different guys that are averaging over 5 yards a carry. And Abram Smith, as you just saw, He just had the big one a moment ago. He's near 100 yards and has had plenty of opportunities on this drive to push it over the century mark. So it's the offensive line really doing a great job throughout the course of this game. It's a big reason why Baylor's in front.
Coach Eric Mateos, his group, has only given up 6 sacks on the entire year. And look at this push they give to Abram Smith, Katie, who just went over 100 yards.
Well, you know, in the past, guys, Gary Bohannon said the skilled players were the benchmark here at Baylor, pushing everyone in practice, raising the level of play. He said this season there's been a dramatic shift. The O-line has now become the hardest working group on the field, and it shows in the way this offense has played through these first couple games.
And they're not the most powerful group. That's what's so amazing. When you talk to Jeff Grimes, he goes, it's not really anything like I've had in the past, like at Auburn or at LSU. It's not even not really a finesse group by any stretch, but it's a group that's better as far as their fundamentals and being able to use athleticism more so than power, and it's been a nice blend to watch.
Second and 3, Smith again, and that'll be another first down. And you know, the guy in the middle, big number 66, Jacob Gall, he's the transfer from Western New York, from the University of Buffalo, and they credit him with this group going from a weakness to a strength. And they ran this wide zone scheme up there at Buffalo.
They did. And they went and wanted to identify a guy that could play center even though he never played center.
Yep.
And ironically enough, the 3 guys you see on your screen right there, the interior part of that offensive lineman, those are all centers.
Well, that's a very good thing, though.
They're all competing for that center spot. It means you have a bunch of guys that are obviously highly competitive and done a great job in the middle of that offensive line.
Smith again on first downs. They're going to grind this thing out. Texas, 2 timeouts remaining as this clock will go under 3 minutes, and Baylor with a 7-point lead. But, you know, listen, we hear from offensive linemen all the time. The centers love to say, hey, we're the smartest guys
right,
on the offensive
right.
line, right? That's why they give us the ball.
If you don't believe them, just ask them.
Yeah, they'll tell you.
But that's true. I mean, you have centers got to make all the calls, and when you have 3 guys on the interior that are all capable of making all the calls, you can probably do a lot of things without even communicating. I mean, you just say, hey, we know what we're doing. Boom, let's call it and run it. So it's a great advantage to have cerebral guys there, and they've been a really fun group to watch this year.
Second and 9. That was a missed handoff there as they went with Drew Estrada on the jet motion. Bohannon put the ball right on his hip, and nearly a costly moment for Baylor. Boy, Texas could have used that.
Oh my goodness, Texas now calls timeout. And you see the hand on the hip. I mean, just couldn't get around in time, and almost a massive mistake there from the Baylor Bears.
Be back after this short break. Boy, did they dodge one. Plus, because it gives you everything, but if you're a Big 12 fan, you gotta have it, right? Big 12 now, you got everything Big 12. Tomorrow, women's soccer championship starts, college basketball right around the corner, so sign up at ESPNplus.com/Big12 now. 2:24 remaining, Texas 1 timeout, 3rd and 14, Longhorns trying to get a stop. And they will, as Baylor played it conservatively, just down the line with Bohannon. Gofu and Ford were able to wrap him up. And the timeout will be used with 2:18 remaining. So they've exhausted their timeouts, but they're getting the ball back, Kevin. So here comes the moment of truth for Texas. Baylor's going to be punting away, 2:18 to play. And you know the way that the script has been going in the month of October for Texas. Big games, big leads, all in the second half. And then all of a sudden these fourth quarters come around and things unravel. Now will come a chance to remedy that.
Yeah, and this is a great opportunity. Defense just got the ball back after a couple mistakes by Baylor. Led to some lost yardage. And now the offense. I mean, they just had a really nice drive. Of course, you need seven. But their quarterback has made good decisions. And I think the run game finally has gotten going. And you can use that a little bit. There's plenty of time on the clock to be able to run your entire offense.
Isaac Power, who has 10 punts over 50 yards, with a very dangerous DeSean Jameson as the return man. Jameson from inside the 30, trying to find some space and good coverage downfield to contain him at about the 31-yard line with 2:07 to play, trailing by a touchdown.
As you can see, Texas has had their well-documented struggles in the second half of football games, but an opportunity to erase some of that narrative right now if they can answer with a drive. And for Casey Thompson here, 2 minutes on the clock. Gotta get the drive started. The first play is by far the most important play in a two-minute drill. Gotta have something positive here to create a little momentum for yourself offensively.
Robinson comes back in to the backfield. Couldn't help out with pass protection as they were trying to set it up to him. And T.J. Franklin came darting in.
Like I said, you could still utilize some of the run game at this point. If you have a favorable box defensively, don't be afraid to hand it to one of the best backs in college football. Him in open space is obviously a problem for the Baylor Bears.
Robinson motions out. Thompson looks left, looks right, trying to extend the play, launches downfield, man open, and it's incomplete. For a moment, it was in the hands of Marcus Washington, but incomplete.
What a play by JT Woods, too. Turning around at the last minute. I mean, oftentimes this will be a pass interference, but you see 22's head go right around, but a great job there breaking it up. But one that Washington absolutely has to bring in. Those game-changing moments, you've got to rise to the occasion, and that time Washington just not able to reel it in.
Third down and 10. Thompson floating backwards, and it's going to be fourth down. Terrell Bernard disrupting things yet again.
Normally in this down and distance, you would be looking in the direction of Jordan Whittington, but he's unavailable. I think your best receiver is Xavier Worthy, number 8.
He has 4 catches for 115 yards and a touchdown today. Right now, they just need 10 yards to stay alive. Fourth down to survive it here at Baylor. Incomplete! Kalen Barnes breaks it up for the Bears.
What a play by Barnes. Just eyes in the backfield the entire time as Thompson gets flushed. Throws a nice pass. I mean, it's right in the numbers. But that's just a great defensive play by Kalen Barnes. Jumping in front, knocking the ball down, and securing the W for the Baylor Bears. What a play by the corner.
Can you believe that it happened again? Red River against Oklahoma, they were up big. Oklahoma State, they were up big. And today against Baylor, Texas again was up double digits. Consecutive losses after leading, heading into the fourth. Not the stat you want to have.
This team's close. I mean, it's hard to put a silver lining on a loss. A loss is a loss, and there's no moral victories when you're the Texas Longhorns. But they're close, man. Golly, it's gut-wrenching for those players to have to go through it again. But you got to give incredible credit to this Baylor football team. So veteran, so much poise, really reflective of their second-year head coach, Dave Aranda. So calm, so cool and collected.
So humble with an edge.
And methodical.
Yes.
I mean, just methodical with how he does things. And this team is playing with a ton of confidence. They can run the football. Their quarterback didn't have his best stuff today, didn't make great decisions. But at the end of the day, the offensive line in that run game was just too much for the Texas Longhorns.
Baylor is 7-1. Baylor does it their way with a new offensive coordinator who plays power football, with a first-year starting quarterback whose confidence is contagious, and with a powerful running back in Abram Smith, who went for 113 yards, a spectacular 32-yard touchdown in the fourth quarter where he spun free. And they believe here in Waco. 31-24. And now, Greg, you think about the Big 12 down the stretch and that path to playing in a championship game. There sits Baylor. Let's go to Katie George down on the field.
Thanks, Tess. Coach Aranda, your defense secures you the victory. What'd you think of their job there on that two-minute drill?
I thought they played it great. You know, just their connection, their communication throughout the halftime, the second half, I thought we really played better than we did when we started the game.
At half, Gary had thrown two interceptions. You told me he was trying to be too perfect. What did you think of his response in the second half?
I think he was able to trust his partners and trust the coaches and just play green and just let it out there. And I think, you know, that's what a great step for him just as a person to be able to do that, because I think that'll cross, you know, these white lines that we're playing on.
This victory puts you at 7-1. I know there's been many factors that have led to this drastic turnaround. Of those factors, what are you most proud of?
I think it's selfless, that no one's standing in front, kind of pounding their chest. Everyone's backing everybody up. Everybody's got real love for one another. Proud to be a part of that.
Congratulations. Enjoy.
Thank you.
And I'm telling you, man, Dave Aranda, what a job he's done. A lot of veteran players, but he's like a samurai, man. He's like a quiet killer. And it's kind of how his team plays as well, man. They have it cooking here in Waco, and they are going to be a handful in November if they can continue to run the football and defend the way they were able to defend tonight. It's going to be a very fun fall here in Central Texas.
This thing looked like it was going the other way early in the third quarter when Bijan Robinson scored the touchdown. Texas was up 21-10. But all of a sudden, the Bears roared, as they have all year long. Baylor wins it 31-24. Coming up next, college football continues. Texas Tech against Oklahoma. But first, let's send you back to our college football scoreboard studio.